I won't hold you too long this morning, but hey, when we go to a movie, it's 2 hours long, and we're only going to get an hour and a half this morning, so don't feel so bad about that. If you look throughout the world at the different Christian denominations alone, you will be blown away at the diversity and the different amounts of denominations. And in America alone, there are over 27 large different Baptist denominations. Then you got a bunch of Methodist denominations. Then you've got a bunch of Lutheran denominations. And not to mention the independent churches and the Pentecostal and the Charismatic and on and on and on and on. But I maintain, and Paul even preached against denominations. Yeah. I maintain that if every church would get the book of James out and start with that, there would be no more denominations in America. The book of James was about the most simplest books as far as theology goes, and it was the very first New Testament book. A lot of people don't know that. It was written by the half-brother of our Lord. Now, Jesus and James had the same mama, but they had a different daddy. James's daddy was Joseph, and Jesus's daddy was the Holy Ghost. Amen. That's what made the difference there. But James was a follower of Jesus, and he wrote about how we're supposed to behave as Christians in the church, out of the church, and everything. And you know, it's time for the church to get back to basic theology instead of all the isms and schisms and ologies and all of this advanced stuff. There is nothing wrong with learning that, but you got to get the basics before you get the other stuff. And the problem with a lot of the churches in America today, they're majoring on the minor. And they haven't gotten back to the basic theology that all of the churches, no matter which one you are, should believe. James in chapter, we're going to look at chapter 2 because we covered chapter 1 a few weeks ago. And this is one that he's talking about, that churches today are guilty of violating this. A lot of churches are. He says, "My brethren, have not the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory, with respect to persons." What does that mean? It means do not favor one member over another. Do not favor one visitor over another. Everybody that walks into the house of God ought to get equal treatment. Ought to be looked upon as the same. Let me tell you this, folks. The ground at the foot of the cross is level. There are no hills and valleys or nothing like that. Nobody is better than somebody else. It don't matter how young you are, you should be treated with the same dignity as the old folks should be. That's true. Everybody should be treated with love. Everybody should be treated with respect. And you know what? Everybody ought to be tickled at seeing you coming in here. Even if you have to fake it sometimes, you know. But seriously, you remember when like new people would come to church and you get all excited about them, then after they've been here for about a month, you know. Got to stop doing that. You got to be excited every Sunday about seeing each other. That's the way it is. And we ought to treat each other the very, very same. Listen to what he said. Now, you know, you would think that the problem of favoritism in the church today is something fairly new. Now, this was going on 2,000 years ago. Listen to this. "For if there come unto your assembly," I love that word, rather, I like that even better than church. I like assembly. "If there come unto your assembly a man with a gold ring in goodly apparel, and there come in a poor man in vile raiment." What is vile raiment? Anybody in here got any vile raiment on? That means old ragged clothes, okay? That's kind of the Sunday morning dress for most of us anyway. I think this church specializes in vile raiment. I love the new fashions. The new fashions are the blue jeans with the whole front ends cut out of them.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's expensive. You pay big money for that.
Yeah.
We were poor, and that's why we had to wear stuff like that back in the 60s. You know, we didn't have no money.
Yeah.
Had patches on it, looked like a car tire.
Yeah.
Said if somebody comes in vile raiment, and you got a man comes in with a gold ring and goodly apparel, and you have respect to him that wears the good clothing, and you say to him, sit here in a good place, and say to the poor, stand over there, or sit under my footstool, are you not then partial in yourselves and become judges of evil thoughts? That goes on in churches today. Somebody will come walking in, and you can tell they got money. You can't. I'm looking for somebody in here that's got money. I ain't found that yet. But I'm just going to say that hypothetically, I reckon. If any of y'all have money, you're hiding it really well. I'm going to get some of our deacons start following some of y'all home to see where you actually live and see what you got and then report back and we'll get you. There's a church over in town, and I will not make mention of it, of the name. But the way they do the offering and tithes every year is the pastor makes people bring their W-2s in.
Oh, wow.
I kid you not. And they look at that and say, now this is how much you got to give, okay? Boy, that's stretching a little bit right there. I'm sorry. Anyway, let me get back on track here. You do not show partiality to somebody in your church because they have money or because they have position. I've seen churches even change their policy to suit somebody that comes in because they're plunking down money in the plate or they got some kind of a big shot job or big shot position, and everybody will change everything for them. I don't care if you're a senator or a congressman or a mayor, heaven forbid, a president, and you walk in here, you're going to find the same thing every Sunday that was here before you got here. It's not going to change for you. You're going to hear the same message and be treated the same way. I worked in a very large church, Donna and I did, many years ago. And I was an adult Sunday school teacher. And this couple comes in there right off the street. They had not been in church no more than a couple of weeks. But everybody knew they had money. The wife was driving a pink Cadillac. Y'all know where that come from. The husband had some big research and development job at a company over in town. They were rolling in the bucks. Well, all of a sudden, they were given positions as Sunday school directors. That church never had a Sunday school director in all the years it had been there. They were Southern Baptists. They had a superintendent. Well, because they had money, they were given Sunday school directors position, both of them. And the first person they decided to focus on was me. I didn't have any money. They started making up rules for my Sunday school class, which was the size of this auditorium, actually. And we had more people in that Sunday school class than is in this church this morning, a very large church. And they told me I was going to have a greeter at the door to greet people when they came in to make them feel more comfortable. I said, they feel comfortable already in here. And so they said, well, if you don't have a greeter, we're going to dismiss you from your Sunday school teacher's position. I said, well, it ain't Walmart, and I ain't changing nothing for y'all. And after about a month, they disappeared. Couldn't find them no more. And I've told this many times. And I called them. I shouldn't have, but I called them. Wanted to know where they were. Well, we got a baby on the way, and we ain't got time for church on Sunday morning. We getting things ready and all. You know, that's kind of like in people, I'm working on getting back into church. You ever seen them? Take some years to do that. All you got to do is get up off your behind and go to church one Sunday.
Amen.
That's how you go back to church. But these people, we got a baby on the way. We ain't got time for none of this. I said, I have five that I get ready every Sunday morning. Me and Donna, we bring them in here and set them down. They don't want to hear no more. Never saw them again. But they were not responsible. They were not qualified. They should not have been given anything because they got it all because of money. So I learned that a long time ago before I started pastoring, that money is going to have a thing to do with what position you hold in church. It's your faithfulness that will get you there.
That's
it. I don't care what kind of education you got or how young or how old you are or whatever. If you are faithful to the Lord, that qualifies you right there. If you're faithful to the Lord's work, that qualifies you to hold a position, in my opinion, my humble opinion. But there are people that suck up to folks that just because they got a position or they got money. And listen to what he said. Hearken or listen, my beloved brethren. Hath not God chosen the poor of the world, rich in faith, and heirs of the kingdom which he has promised to them that love him? Do you know that poor folks get more work done in the church than the rich folks do? Get quiet in here. Somebody's got money. They're not saying amen. Who are you? Find out who it is. But I'm serious. The people that feel like they have nothing else in the world but the Lord do more for the Lord. You know, when God is all you have, God is all you need. But there are people that feel like they don't need God because they got Medicare Part B, Part C. I'm sick of them commercials on TV. Y'all sire, every 2 seconds there's Joe Namath up there whining like a little girl about his Medicare, and I'm going to volunteer to deliver meals to his house. That's what he said he needed, so I'm going to take meals to Joe Namath's house. J.J. Walker. Y'all notice how ugly he got after he lost his hair? Whew. And all them people up there carrying on, the only one that looked decent was poor old William Shatner.
Yeah.
All right. I don't know why I'm preaching on that this morning. I need to get back. We think we've got plans to fall back on. That's our problem. But if you have got nothing else to fall back on but the Lord, you can do miracles. You can do miracles. Now, he said, but you have despised the poor. Churches despising the poor? Yeah, they have. There are churches that have been guilty of mistreating people because they were poor. And he said, but do not rich men oppress you and draw you before the judgment seat? Do they not blaspheme that worthy name by which you are called? And we see that all the time, these big corporate executives blaspheming God and belittling people and taking advantage of people. Dialysis costing $25,000 a month. Give me a break. The medical profession has lost its mind. They've gone buck wild over money. I got doctors that watch me every Sunday, and I'm sorry, but y'all know it's true too. They've gone crazy. And it's all over the love of money, and people are treating people ugly over the love of money. We see it all the time. But he said, if you fulfill the royal law according to the scripture that you shall love your neighbor as yourself, you do well. That's the whole litmus test right there. Are you willing to treat strangers that come in the church as well as you would treat yourself? As much as you love yourself, you are going to love other people. If we do that, that won't make no difference about denomination, won't make no difference about any of that. Everything will run smooth. And he said, but if you have respect to persons, or if you show favoritism, you commit sin and are convicted of the law as a transgressor. In other words, you're guilty of violating the law of God by treating people differently. For whosoever shall keep the whole law and yet offend in one point, he is guilty of all. Well, Dave, I ain't ever killed nobody. I haven't committed adultery. I just showed a little favoritism in church. Well, he said, well, you're guilty of all of it. He said, for he that said, do not commit adultery, also said, do not kill. But if you commit no adultery, but yet if you killed, you're still a transgressor of the law. So speak ye, and so do as they that shall be judged by the law of liberty. He is telling us, rather than judging people because of their status and looking down on people because maybe they have no status. And it said, for that person will have judgment without mercy. And buddy, let me tell you something. We don't need judgment. We need mercy. Amen. For he that showed no mercy, and mercy rejoices against judgment. Now, here James is going to tread on some really thin ice. As a matter of fact, when all the councils got together to compile the different books of the Bible, they almost left James out because they did not understand what he was trying to say. And then thank God some other anointed scholars got in there and explained it, and then they left James alone. But listen to what he said. What does it profit, my brethren, though a man said he has faith and has no works, can that faith save him? Now listen to this. If a brother or sister be naked and destitute of daily food. Now, Solid Rock Church, thank God, runs about the largest food bank that I have ever seen in my life. So much stuff goes in. A lot of y'all have no idea the amount of people that's being ministered to, not only locally, but in nursing homes and other places as far away as Petersburg, is taken care of by this church. You don't know. And then the missions work that goes on. And then the clothes that go out by the trailer load to towns where they have no money and the people are poor. A lot of you have no idea the inner workings and the amount of people that it takes to do this work. But listen to this. Say, for instance, you see somebody doesn't have any clothes and they're destitute of daily food, and then you say to them, depart in peace and be ye warmed and filled. Anybody can say that. But what are you going to do about it? That's what he's saying about faith and works. You can talk all you want, but what are you going to do something about it? And it says right here, notwithstanding you give them not those things which are needful to the body. What did that profit? Didn't do a bit of good. Tina could really save a lot of effort if she would stand at the door down there every day when the food bank is open and leave it locked, stand outside of it and go, y'all depart now and be warmed and filled. That wouldn't last very long, would it? Because they're getting nothing. Nobody's getting fed. They're just getting talked to. The people that we do missions work for, that we go down and deliver trailer loads of clothes and food and toys and everything else, talk doesn't do them a bit of good. People do that all day long. And so he said, even so faith, if it have not works, is dead. If you don't put any feet to your faith, it's not real faith. It's not that work saves you. That's not what he's saying. But you are, listen to this. Let me sum it up. You are not saved by works of any kind.
Yes.
But you are saved to do works of every kind.
That's right.
That's what the Bible is saying here. A man may say, you have faith and I have works. Show me your faith without your works, and I'll show you my faith by my works. Rather than bragging about the faith that you got, why don't you do something about it? There is enough stuff to do in this church alone to keep you going until about a week after Judgment Day. I don't think the Lord's going to make you work that long. But buddy, we got. Somebody came to me the other day and said, you know, when I started coming to church here and started working here, I feel useful now. I feel like I have a purpose. And I said, well, I can promise you with the projects we got going, you're going to feel useful until I'm about 85 years old. Then it won't really matter after that because I won't know who you are probably. But seriously, don't ever tell me you have nothing to do because you're telling that to Pharaoh.
Come see me.
That's right. Go see, you want to see, meet one of Pharaoh's taskmasters? There she is. She'll put you to work. There is so much that needs to be done. We cannot do it all. We're trying. But I'm amazed at our people, their deacons and their missionaries that are getting the job done, and there's so much more to do.
Amen.
Then he kind of laughs at the people that think that, well, I believe there's a God. Like, that's going to get you to heaven. Thou believest that there is one God? He said, thou doest well. That's old English for whoop-de-doo. He said, thou believest that there is one God? Thou doest well. The devils also believe and tremble. The devil believes in God. He knows God exists. But he's not saved, and he doesn't trust him as a savior. Of course not. But the devil knows that God exists better than you do. So don't say, I'm on my way to heaven because I believe there's a God. Everybody knows that. He said, but will you know, O vain man, that faith without works is dead? Was not Abraham our father justified by works when he had offered Isaac his son upon the altar? Seest how faith wrought with his works, and by works was faith made perfect? Folks, if you say you have faith, you better prove it. God expects you to put your faith to work. Anybody can talk. Anybody can talk the talk, but walking the walk is what impresses God. That's what he's looking for. And I'll let you go in just a minute. And the scripture was fulfilled, which said, Abraham believed God, and it was imputed or counted unto him for righteousness, and he was called the friend of God. And so you see then how that by works a man is justified and not by faith only. Not by faith only. You have to put some feet to your faith. Likewise also was Rahab the harlot justified by works when she had received the messengers and sent them out another way, and she saved their life, and they spared her when they took Jericho out. For as the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without works is dead also. Put feet to your faith and serve God. You can pray, you can witness, you can do things for him by serving out of a church. There's 100 things, but show him you love him by working for him and serving him. Show people that you truly do have faith by actually doing something about it.
Yeah.
You are the Bible that most people read alone. People are not just going to pick up a Bible and start reading it until they see something in you that makes them want to do that. And so you show them from your life what the scriptures say and what the scriptures mean. And let people look at your life and say, you know, that's something that he or she has that I don't have, and I want that. That's how people start paying attention to the gospel. It's how you show your faith by your works. Folks, let's stand.
Pledge allegiance to the land. With all my strength, with all I am, I will seek to honor his command. I pledge allegiance to the land.
I have heard how Christians long ago, who were brought before a tyrant's throne, they were told that he would spare their lives if they would renounce the name of Christ. But one by one they chose to die. The Son of God they would not deny. Like a great angelic voice, I can almost hear their voices ring. I pledge allegiance to the land. With all my strength, with all I am, have come, and the years have gone, and the cause of Jesus still goes on. Now our time has come to count the cost, to reject this world, to embrace the cross. The one who died to give us life, till the trumpet sounds on that final day. Let us proudly stand and boldly say, I will seek to honor his commands. I pledge allegiance to the Lamb.
I pledge allegiance to the Lamb with all.